Welcome to Munster Movie Night. I am Bobby Gelmunster, your internet horror host, along with Boris T. Buzzard. Are you ready to scream? That's right, Dr. Paul. That's right. Sorry, Dr. Paul Bearer, too. That's right. This is Bobby Gelmunster, and yes, I was wondering, perhaps, what? Oh, look, I can't help that Eddie Munster liked the shirt that I sent you for Christmas. I mean, it was the Munster shirt, but I thought you'd get a kick out of it, maybe rubbing it in his nose or something. I didn't know that he was going to like it so much. I mean, really, well, okay, I tell you what, maybe I can find something equally obnoxious for him to rub in your nose, hmm? No? You don't know? Well, anyway, look, getting back to my point, Dr. Paul, the thing is, tonight, I was really hoping to show a movie called, hang on one second, Boris, what was it called? What? Are you sure? Okay. Really? It's called that. Yeah, okay. Well, anyway, it's a Mexican film made in 1961 or 62, somewhere in that era, called Brainiac. Really? It's called The Brainiac. I don't know. But anyway, yes, I was hoping maybe you could give me some ideas for the show. Hmm? What? Oh, okay. So, all right. So I really do need to talk to Eddie Munster. Oh, okay. All right, so, well, sorry, Dr. Paul. Anyway, well, thanks anyway for the advice. I'm not sure that I can get a hold of Eddie Munster, him being such a big star and Hello? Dr. Paul? Hello? Oh, well. Well, Boris, you have to be very careful what you say to these stars because they have such low tolerance of, or high tolerance, or touchy, that's the word, perhaps. Yes, very touchy about what you say. Anyway, well, hello out there. And welcome to Munster Movie Night. I am your internet horror host, Bobby Gelmunster, along with my co-host and co-fiend, Boris T. Buzzard. And you're in for a treat tonight, my dear fiends. A treat. And maybe a little bit of a trick as well. Because tonight's film is called The Brainiac. And it was made in Mexico. But don't worry, for you English-speaking peoples out there, it's got a lot of English in it as well. In fact, I believe it may be quite dubbed. Anyway, I thought I'd get a few ideas. I had hoped to get some from Dr. Paul Bearer II, you know, him being down in Tampa, Florida, in his castle, tenement castle, that is, right, Boris? Exactly. But the only advice he could give me was to call Edward Munster. And so I'm a little bit afraid to call Edward Munster. Yeah, he's so busy and he's such a big star. And anyway, so I decided I'd get some ideas from my trusty old book, The Spanish Inquisition. And there is some really interesting ideas there. There's the Wheel of Pain, and then there's the cage itself. The Iron Maiden. We did a show about not too long ago about the Iron Maiden, and anyway, that's a lot of good ideas. Well, not to worry. I'm sure it'll come to us as the time goes by through the film. Anyway, get ready for tonight's monstrous horriblest, scariest film yet seen here on Monster Movie Night called The Brainiac. Let's go to it right now.
Inquisitor, protector of the faith against heretic sins of apostasy in the city of Mexico and all the states and dominions in the province of New Spain and its viceroyalties and governing bodies through royal audiences in all the cities and states do proclaim that the other inquisitors and I have attended this hearing in the secret chamber of the Holy Tribunal of the Inquisition in Mexico to do justice in the trial that has been initiated against the aforementioned Baron Vitellius of Estera, of unknown origin, who has repeatedly refused to state same. Aware of the edicts and merits of this trial, and the evidence and suspicion resulting thereof.
Report on the sentence and the trial by torment that this tribunal of the Holy Inquisition instituted against said Baron Vitellius for heresy and the instigation of heresy, for practicing dogmatism, for having used witchcraft, superstitions, and conjurations for depraved and dishonest ends, for having employed the art of necromancy, invoking the dead, and trying to foretell the future through the use of corpses, for having seduced married women and maidens, having taken note of the facts of this trial, we sentenced Count Vitellius to be subjected to torment as far as is justified. And we warned him that if during said torment he should be maimed in any way or should die, or his blood should be drawn in carrying out the sentence, this would serve as proof of his guilt and show that he had not repented. As soon as he was informed of this sentence, the accused declared that he actually welcomed the decision and that this holy tribunal could torment him all it wished. And therefore, he was conducted to the torture chamber and his arms were trussed behind his back. The rope was then tightened by being twisted 30 times in a row, but the accused merely laughed with disdain at these acts of justice. Because of this bold defiance, he was then laid upon the rack, and with his arms and legs almost torn from his body, he continued to make jest of our holy authority. When the inquisitors witnessed this spectacle, they ordered that the torment be ceased. But since they felt that he had not received sufficient punishment, they ordered that the torture be repeated whenever deemed necessary. When the accused was notified of this decision, he declared that he would welcome as much torment as we wished to give him. At that time, his bonds were cut, and he was taken to a small jail cell close to the torture chamber, from where he has been brought to this room to receive our decision and our sentence. And now, as if our justice had not been sufficiently ridiculed, a witness has come before this tribunal to defend the accused. This is the epitome of all brazen defiance, Lord Inquisitors. Now tell me, are we going to stand for it?
We order the witness to be brought before us in the secret chamber. This holy tribunal has been given to understand that you have come before us to present evidence in defense of the accused.
That is the truth, Lord Inquisitor.
And do you know, young man, that he who presents himself before the tribunal of the Holy Inquisition in this country is under the obligation to have a full knowledge of the truth and to tell only the truth at all times?
I know, sir. I shall.
Then let us hear your story. Who are you?
My name is Marcos Miranda. I first saw light in a village called Quiana in Portugal.
And what do you have to say in favor of the accused?
I'd like to say that I know that Baron Vitellius is an honorable man, Your Grace. A man of many virtues, respected for his knowledge that he has dedicated to the promotion of fine arts and sciences.
He has helped the downtrodden people in this new land.
Have you ever heard anything more absurd, Lord Inquisitor?
Marcos Miranda, the farce that you have tried to perpetrate has earned you the punishment of 200 lashes, which will be applied immediately in the torture chamber.
Has come to an end. And the Lord Inquisitors have heard all the evidence that was to be presented. As a result, this tribunal of the Holy Inquisition established in New Spain has seen fit to condemn the impenitent Baron Vitellius of Estera to be dressed in the clothing of shame bearing symbols of fire. He will undergo personal debasement before the people. All his lands and possessions will be confiscated. And finally, he will be burned to death in an open field.
My body is to be burned. It will be without chains.
Bigger than mountains.
Thank you.
Baltazar of Manesis. Alvaro Contreras. Sebastian of Pantoja. Galindo Duval. I shall return to your world within 300 years. When that comet completes its cycle and is once again in these latitudes. When that happens, I will take my revenge upon you. I will kill each and every one of your descendants, and I shall expunge your foul lineage from this earth. I almost forgot. It's 11:45. If we don't hurry, we're going to be late.
You two have other plans, it seems.
I'm terribly sorry. You see, we're going to talk to the professor at the observatory. It's something important.
You must like your work.
Don't forget, I chose to be an astronomer. I work in the dark. We're looking for a real star, and there are no clouds tonight.
So long, you two.
So long.
I'm sorry we're late, Milan, but we are invited out to have a drink.
Don't worry about that, Ronnie. I knew you'd be here on time.
How's your memory tonight, Vicky? Of all the reappearing comets that you've studied, can you remember at least two that are very important and how often they appear near Earth?
Well, Olver's every 72 years it draws near Earth. Halley's cycle is every 76.
Perfect. It's your turn, Ronnie. Tell me, Halley's draws near the Sun, but how close does the comet get to the Sun?
3,258,000,000 miles, Professor.
Mm, and in its perihelion?
I think 54 million miles.
Perfect, young man. Well, I'm glad you two came to the observatory tonight, because it's especially important. Look at these.
Now, these books here were written around 300 years ago, and they all mention in one section the appearance of a strange comet, a comet that was seen during 1661. Now, an astronomer making a thorough investigation just might think that they refer to the great comet that was sighted during 1680. That is, the one that helped Isaac Newton when he demonstrated that all comets, in the very same manner as the planets in our solar system, are governed by constant solar attraction. Nevertheless, we found that the great comet that was seen during 1680 differed from the others since its orbit was parabolic and since the Sun was its focal point. In spite of that, based on the predictions that are mentioned in these books, we can be sure that the comet that was seen in 1661 moves
along an elliptical orbit. What it means is that we're tracking a comet that's periodic. There are some interesting details relating to all this. Now listen. According to my calculations, this comet that was seen in 1661 is bound to appear above our Earth within a precise time limit, 2,624,600 sidereal hours. In other words, this comet that was seen during 1661 is bound to appear in the field of vision of our telescope at exactly 2:36 this morning, moving along this perihelion, with the same orbit as the Earth, at a calculated distance of approximately 53 million miles.
But, Professor, it's due here right now. I found Andromeda, Professor, but I can't see the comet.
No. You're never going to find it that way. You're aiming toward the northern latitudes. Move it towards the south. Bear to the south. I'm sure you'll see it soon. Center it on Orion's belt now. I think that's where you're going to find it.
Nothing yet, Professor.
It's not possible. I think something's gone wrong.
I'm sure I found it.
Yes, there it is. I can see it now, Ronnie. I wasn't mistaken. What a splendid spectacle. We're certainly fortunate tonight. I, for one, feel proud that my work hasn't failed. Take a look.
Permit me.
Come, we'll watch it from outside.
There it is. There it is. I see it.
How beautiful.
I don't understand. The comet just let out a very strange light. Come on. We'd better investigate. sir. Did you see a small aerolite land near here?
An aerolite?
Yes.
No. You appear surprised to see me, my friend. I think I should explain. You see, I always take my walks at this hour of the night.
Oh, then let me explain also. You see, sir, we're astronomers. And we were observing a meteor.
Oh, but Ronnie, this gentleman doesn't understand a thing that you're saying to him.
Young lady, I understand much more than you can imagine. Astronomy is my weakness. As a science, it's most important. And another thing, I studied it for years. I'm quite proficient.
Oh, really?
Yes.
In that case, permit me to offer you my card. Whenever you can visit us, I'd be more than glad to show you my work, sir. Our professor is Harold Milland.
I'd be glad to. Well, good night.
Good night.
And who are you? I didn't see you come in.
I'm sorry, buddy, but the law says I can't serve you this late.
Oh, he's an old friend of mine. Give him one drink, won't you, please?
You win, but one, and then we close. Serve that man a cognac. After that, you can go. No need to wait.
You know what? I got a strange feeling that you and I have met someplace else, honey. But I feel foggy right now. You're real sweet, so please don't think you bother me or anything like that. Bobby doesn't like to see me with men. He thinks I shouldn't have any friends. You're my friend. Let's drink. You got here, haven't said one single word to me. But that stare in your eyes says so much to me. To tell you the truth, it makes me feel afraid. Keep staring. I don't want you to stop looking at me. I guess it's just useless.
Ah!
That is such a wonderful film, Boris. It's got so many great ideas about how to decorate the dungeon and everything. I only wish we had a dungeon. I guess we could take one of the other rooms, maybe the bedroom, perhaps. I mean, it's sort of like a dungeon in its own way, and then we could add our, maybe we could make a mini dungeon. That would be great to have, you know, some mini torture devices in it. And speaking of which, we could probably add these wonderful models by weirdos. We are speaking of the Iron Maiden at the beginning of the show. Well, here's a wonderful model kit, the Iron Maiden, and it's got the little fellow inside of it, and it's got those nice little spikes, and plus you got a nice little Igor as well to help you out torturing the fellow that's inside of it, you see, as you can see on the back. Anyway, that's one of the mini torture devices. Here is the wheel rack, or wheel of pain. Wow, that looks really movable parts too. I mean, what monster kid wouldn't love to have one of these, you know, for their birthdays, death days, any holiday whatsoever for monsters? You can see, okay, and as you can see on the back, Igor is somewhat kind of giving encouragement to the dude that's being wrapped on the wheel of pain. I'm pretty sure he'll tell Igor anything he wants to know. And of course, tonight's film, made in Mexico, 1961, very great date that was dear to my heart, 1961. Speaking of which, here we have a wonderful Day of the Dead skeleton. How monstrously he looks, and he's so decorative as well. Right, Boris? I mean, you could put him pretty much in any room, and he would bring out the decor, the splendor, the loveliness of the room, especially if it's got black curtains. So cheery, right, Boris? I think so. I'll let my wife figure that part up. Decorating is her domain, so I try not to tread too much into it. I mean, sometimes we'll give a little advice, you know, the Iron Maiden, the wheel, the spiked bed of nails, you know, and well, actually we have a small cushion of nails, but you know, space is, space does, as they always say. Right, Boris? Anyway, Mexico has a lot of traditions that, like Day of the Dead, and of course the Spanish Inquisition. I mean, what we couldn't have done without that, or could we? I mean, they rack them, they rake them, they burn them, they hang them, they torture them, and yet we come back for more. Why? Because we like it. Anyway, maybe that would be a new chapter for my book, Horror Hosting for Dummies, you know. Thanks to Dr. Paul Bearer on that one, Paul Bearer II on that one as well. I mean, he's such a hoot. We just deathly loving, or loving to death. Yes, maybe that's the word, right? Okay, yes, we do. Anyway, let us get back to the Brainiac.
In the years that I've been working in this morgue, I've never run across a case like this. The skulls of these two victims show two perforations. Possibly the murderer used an electric drill. I say this because the person who did it was quite skilled. Just look at these two orifices. A most astounding thing has occurred in these cases. You see, the cephalic matter was sucked out through these small openings. Please look at this. The same little holes in exactly the same place that they were bored in that other fellow's skull.
Yeah. Identical characteristics in both cases. Doc, I'm sure that the killer made the preparations.
And the person who did it is an expert in anatomy, too.
I wish they'd find some way to control the subjects a man studies. A maniac with a lot of knowledge is a threat. It's certainly a strange coincidence. Last night, the bank was robbed on 2nd Street. The thieves stole Fausen and jewels, and all the cash in the safe, too. And there's not a single clue.
But what's that got to do with this dead body, Chief?
The bank's on the same block where we found this girl's corpse right after she was laid out, Benny.
I just figured the whole business out, Chief. Now, just for fun, let's suppose that the girl saw the robbery and the criminal wanted to make sure she wouldn't talk.
You're a smart boy, Benny. Only there's one mistake. I guess you forgot that they found the other guy out on the highway. It's 26 miles to that location.
Yeah, I guess so. Well, fine. Then the investigation is ended and it seems foolish to go on. I'm sorry, Chief.
Thank you, and pardon me for the trouble.
Not at all. I'm at your service.
Let's go.
Thank you very much. In front of this place stood the crematory of from 1596 to 1771. Directed by colonial and republican movements.
See the archives. I'm sorry, but it's time for us to close.
Processes of the Inquisition. Done in the year of 1661. Baltazar Meneses. Alvaro Contreras. Sebastián Pantoja. Erlindo Abduvar.
Got a match for me?
Let's see the medical report, Chief.
This crime is identical to the others. Cranium perforated, and it could have been by an electric drill. And as usual, Benny, his brains have been sucked out.
Oh, gosh, Chief, I was really enjoying this sweet roll.
I'm sure now that the killer's a schizophrenic. Tomorrow early, I'll start posting men throughout the whole city.
You order a calf's brain, sir.
This doesn't make any sense. The comet's well within our field of vision, Ronnie, and I can't find a trace. A comet doesn't just disappear, and it doesn't go into another orbit all of a sudden. I can't explain.
Why, it's completely absurd.
I think you need a little rest, Professor. We've been at work for 2 weeks, and you're exhausted.
Could it be that the whole thing's a hallucination?
A hallucination? No, Ronnie, no. That comet exists, Ronnie. We both saw it.
Professor?
Thank you.
Nothing. Hold on. Nothing. 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 Not one of my colleagues has even sighted the comet.
Says Baron Battalius of Astera considers it an honor to invite you to the reception that he is giving at his new residence on Falcon Hill. On Monday, the 21st, and he expects us to get there around 9 o'clock.
Baron Battalius of Astera? Who is he?
I never met the guy. But that's not important. What's important is that we'll be able to forget that comet, for tonight at least.
Thought I'd never find you, Chief. Look, at last we're getting important. They invited us to a party for Blue Bloods. Well, at least you're invited.
Baron Battalius of Astera. This isn't an invitation. You and I are supposed to be at the party, but only as watchdogs. Naturally, many guests will wear their jewels, Benny, and that could attract our local crooks.
But the food and drink is free, isn't it? So who cares? Service, please.
Mr. and Mrs. Louis Meneses.
Meneses? Mr. Meneses, it's a pleasure. Won't you come in?
We are truly honored, Baron.
Thank you.
Miss Ana Luisa Vivar and Mr. Francis Correa.
Mr. Vivar, Mr. Correa.
Baron.
Please go in.
Thank you.
Professor Indalecio Pantoja.
It's an honor to welcome such an illustrious historian to this house.
Thank you, Baron Astera. And now that we've met, the honor is mine, since I know your reputation as a gentleman, sir.
Come in, Professor.
This is Victoria Contreras, Professor Ronald Miranda, and Professor Samuel Thomas Milan.
Miss Contreras, Ronald, it's certainly a pleasure to see you again. Professor Milland, my congratulations. You've chosen two fine collaborators, and I confess I admire them.
And I'm glad to hear you say it, Baron. It's true. As young astronomers, they are both able and intelligent.
Won't you please come in? Permit me.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Professor.
Thank you, Baron. Join us.
Don't think I'm rude. It so happens liquor does me damage. I once had a very strange disease.
Really, Baron, that's a shame.
Your health.
Thank you.
Is there anything the matter, Baron?
Just a pain I feel occasionally. Go on and join the other guests. Excuse me, please.
Now, Benny, listen, you need to keep your eyes open. Don't forget that these high society get-togethers attract the most daring and intelligent crooks.
And there are plenty of suspects here, right, Chief?
You stick close to the entrance here. I'll be in among the Baron's guests.
I admire all the facets of pre-Hispanic culture. And that's the real reason I wanted to come and visit your country. It has so much beauty.
I think you'd be very pleased to review the documents that I spent many years evaluating and interpreting, Baron.
Thank you very much.
Don't forget, you promised us you'd attend our wedding, Baron.
I'm privileged to have been invited, young lady.
We've all had a delightful time.
You were most kind.
As concerns my offer, it was sincere, Baron. I'll consider it an honor to have you at my home.
Thanks again, Professor.
It's been a pleasure.
Why, thank you.
The observatory is at your disposal whenever you decide to visit us, so don't forget, Baron.
Well, as soon as I can, I'll drop in and have a chat with you.
We'll say goodnight now, Baron.
Good night, Miss Contreras.
Good night, sir.
Good night. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Don't you think it's time we beat it, Chief? You know, I bet those crooks heard we'd be at the party, and that's why they stayed home.
I guess you're right. Come on, Benny.
All these decrees here belonged to the Inquisition during the second half of the 1600s, right here.
Don Sebastián of Pantoja.
You know, in this century, to talk about the Holy Inquisition and the ways they did justice is not what I'd call easy. There exists a legend.
working at this late hour?
My daughter, Maria of Pantoja, this is Baron Vitellius of Estera.
Baron, how do you do?
Baron Estera, my daughter is my pride and joy. Since I lost my wife, she's always been at my side. This year she's getting her degree, a doctorate in history.
Huh? My congratulations. There's no subject quite as interesting as yours, right?
Allow me to say that she's a real authority on religious history.
Oh, Papa, please be quiet. These degrees certainly are interesting, aren't they, Baron?
She means they were written in a very interesting way. When you read this, you can see perfectly well that religion was not extremely enlightened at that time, Baron. Right here, for example. Now, that's strange. Here it tells about a trial. And the accused had the same name as yours. Here.
This history tells us about the trial, torment, and resulting sentence carried out by the authorities of the Holy Inquisition and held in the city of Mexico. This all happened in the year 1661 against Vitellius of Estera, whose origin was unknown and was never discovered. For heresy and for furthering heresy, for dogmatizing, for having used sorcery, superstition and conjuring for evil ends that all men are attracted to, for making recourse to magic and employing necromancy, and also for trying to see into the future by employing dead bodies, for seducing young maidens that couldn't resist. Now, the interesting thing is, what was his sentence? It says here, after the prisoner had undergone torment that was considered justified, the authorities of the Inquisition sentenced the accused to disgrace. The next day, he was dressed in the crown and shirt of fire, exposed to public ridicule. They confiscated his wealth. He refused to repent, and he was burned.
This Vitellius of Estera must have been one of your ancestors, Baron.
No. I never had any ancestors. I was condemned and was burned alive.
By that man there, Sebastian of Pantoja.
You see, I'm Vitellius of Estera.
Forgive me, Baron, but, well, this type of joke is in very poor taste.
You know it's impossible.
Thank you.
These people here were burned, only that doesn't fool me. It's clear that that madman extracted their brains as well. He tried to use fire to erase the incriminating evidence. The experts in the laboratory should examine these two corpses. And you better go along, let me know when they have all the data.
Right, Chief. All right, you heard the orders. Take these bodies down to the laboratory at headquarters. I gotta examine them to find out who drilled those holes in their skulls. It probably was just some maniac that thought he was cracking a safe. And don't forget to tag all the bones well, because if you lose one, I might get mixed up.
What a shocking tragedy this is.
What tragedy? The eminent scholar and historian Indalecio Pantoja and his daughter murdered by a completely maniacal killer.
That's impossible.
I hate to say it, Professor, but it's the truth.
Poor man. And Maria, this is frightening news. And to think he was so happy and in such fine spirits at the Baron's house, it's incredible.
More reports, Professor?
Ah, yes. Thank you. London. Nothing. Moscow. All bad news. San Francisco. Like Moscow. Paris. Nothing. Nothing. No one has seen anything. They all say they haven't sighted the comet. This is so frustrating, Ronnie. And nevertheless, I saw it with my own two eyes, and you too saw it. Isn't that true?
Certainly.
Sure we did, Professor. I say something's pretty strange when three people don't know what they saw.
It's right here in black and white. Let me see. I read it. Here. No, here. Page 200. Here. Comet scene. But it's not true. A sorcerer.
You've really done a great job. The foundry you've built is just marvelous. Now I know why people are starting to say that your business is helping to build the economy, sir.
Thank you so much, Baron. But the success is mostly due to the hard work and the sacrifices of my husband, you know.
She deserves much more credit than I. You must see the laboratory. I think you'll be interested in seeing the furnaces where I experiment with new alloys. It's right this way, Baron.
As I said, I can show you proof of my theory. Using this amalgamation, I can make a new alloy that's completely unknown. A metal that can resist tremendous temperatures.
Will this furnace give you sufficient heat for your experiment?
Certainly. It's true that I'll need heat, but that furnace is quite sufficient. Let me have the metals and the chemical components I've enumerated, and I can assure you of success.
It sounds marvelous. And this new metal can amass a fortune for us. Forgive my eagerness, Baron. It's clear that money is not important to you because you're only interested in your theory.
You're quite right, sir.
Menezes, descendant of the accursed Inquisitor Baltazar of Menezes, who ordered me to be burned alive. You will forfeit your life for the life that he took from me 3 centuries ago.
According to the evidence gathered yesterday, it seems the couple burned to death when that section caught fire right after the explosion.
No matter how hard I fight it, I'm still convinced that this Baron Battalius is a bad omen. You know Pantoja as well as Menezes showed up at his house that evening. They're both dead.
Ronnie, that's nonsense. Now finish eating. There's work to do at the observatory.
Baron Battalius of Astera. Please wait here. I'll call him, sir.
Is there something I can do for you, gentlemen?
Good evening, Baron. I'm sorry to bother you, but I need some vital information.
I'll tell you what I can.
You most likely heard all about the murders that I traced to some mad killer.
Why, yes.
Yes, I heard about the killings. But who's the murderer? Did you find that out?
Baron, that's precisely the thing I'm investigating. Tell me. Do you know that just a few days ago,
Pantoja was killed? He's that great historian.
I heard about his death.
And that last night, they set fire to the foundry, and that Louis Menezes and his wife died under circumstances that seemed to be related?
You can't mean it, Inspector. Such a good man, what a pity. A couple of nights ago, he was here at the house.
That's why I came here to visit you, Baron. Because since you're a friend of his, I thought you'd give me some information that could turn out to be useful.
It's too bad, Inspector, but I think I'd better tell you that I wasn't really friendly with any of the victims. I met them through mutual friends in Europe. I send invitations out to the whole group automatically, but as you know, Inspector, I just recently came to live here.
I recall you mentioned that fact the other night. Much obliged, Baron. Now, excuse me, please.
Another thing, Inspector. Call on me whenever you like.
Inspector, undoubtedly, you'll have the occasion to be seeing the families. Please be so kind as to give them my sympathy.
That's quite impossible, Baron. There's no one left to feel sorry for now. Excuse me, please. Come on, Benny.
Thank you.
Now that all the wedding guests have gone, may I offer my congratulations and wish you all kinds of joy. Sorry I wasn't able to get here on time, but I had some affairs to handle.
Ah, but you got here, so don't worry, Baron.
We thank you for the present, Baron. It was the best, truly it was.
I'm gratified to hear it. It was a pleasure.
Please come and visit us whenever you can. We'll be waiting.
Thank you. I'd like to visit you. But you must be in a hurry. You're going by plane?
There's going to be a short delay, Baron. I'm closing a big business deal this week. But I'll call you as soon as we get back to the city next month.
Excellent. I wish you the best of luck, Baron.
Please excuse us.
You couldn't make the wedding. That's too bad, Baron. Anna Louise asked for you.
Yes, I explained and they forgave me. Hello, Vicky. How are you today?
I'm tired. Our work is fatiguing.
That's right. We've been working hard and very late. That comet that disappeared has us going crazy. The professors are shut in the observatory. She and I are always at his side.
You mean to say you're still hoping this strange comet is going to reappear?
Certainly. We saw it once. Vicky was there.
Yes.
It appeared the same night we ran into you out there in the woods.
Who could forget such a meeting? We became friends then, did we not?
Now you're flattering us, Baron.
Surely you know now that a lunatic killed the Pantojas and the Meneses? I met them previously in your house.
Yes. I heard about the tragedies. A horrible thing.
It's really a strange coincidence, isn't it? The two were together at your house. Do you remember, don't you, Baron? They were dead 2 days later. Strange, isn't it, Baron?
Just a minute. You mean to say a brilliant scientist like you was superstitious?
It's not superstition, really. It's only curiosity.
Your forefather was a judge. The Inquisitor Helindo of Vivar was at the trial and ordered me to be burned. And you, Ana Luisa of Vivar, are to pay the penalty.
Thank you. Come on.
Hey, Chief, don't you think it'd be a good idea to get out of this dripping apartment house?
Come on, Benny.
The same twin orifices in the cranium, and the victim's brains have been sucked out.
Balthazar Meneses, Alvaro Contreras, Sebastian Pantoa, Herlindo Vivar, Luis Meneses, Indalecio Pantoa, Ana Luisa Vivar, Victoria Contreras.
When I finish doing the autopsies, I'll send you back the information you'll be needing.
I'll be back, Doctor.
I'm sure they haven't separated, Inspector. Now let's see. They must have left about an hour ago. Are you concerned?
Professor, it's very urgent that we find these two right away. Any minute now, they could be dead.
I'm getting scared, Inspector. Ronnie and Victoria were invited to dinner tonight, and their host is Baron Vitellius of Estera on Falcon Hill.
Thank you, Professor. We better make it snappy. Come on.
And I suppose we're going to the Baron's house, Chief.
You're brilliant. But first to headquarters. You like speed so much, so stand on that accelerator.
Okay.
Are you still having that pain, Baron?
It gets better as each day goes by.
You're taking care of yourself?
All that's necessary, Victoria. All that's necessary. I'm anxious to get my hands on that information that you said you'd have for us, so that we can locate the comet of 1661.
You're too impatient. Try to calm down. You'll have to wait another 20 minutes. Meanwhile, I'll go for my medicine. Excuse me, please.
Miranda, I just remembered that you two plan to be married very soon now. Surely you'll permit me on this occasion to give Victoria a jewel.
Consider it my wedding gift, please. You might call that an expression of affection and friendship a lonely man shows.
Baron, you're overwhelming us with your kindness. We hate to be a burden.
On the contrary, Miranda, I am delighted. Permit me.
Can't you wait a little while?
Don't forget there's a 20-minute wait before you can locate the comet. The jewels are in my office, and I'd like Victoria to choose anything she desires. You shouldn't influence her. You don't trust me?
Certainly I trust you, Baron.
Be completely confident of Vitellius of Estera, Ronald.
Thank you.
They're lovely, aren't they? How about you? None can compare with your tender gaze. It's too bad you can't be mine alone. I long to love you and adore you above all, I swear it. But there's no way now. My hate is much stronger than my love. Like a master, no one can control. Why did destiny elect you? Why, I want to know. Victorio Contreras. The descendant of that accursed inquisitor, Alvaro Contreras. 300 years ago, that man ordered me burned. Yes, me. I'm Batalius of Estera. But at last I returned my love to have my revenge on Earth. And you are the last living descendant, do you understand?
I must carry out my revenge. Your ancestor defended me 300 years ago. Don't make me forget it. Nothing can stop me.
Run, Victoria. Run!
Well, my fiends, how did you enjoy the film? Got a lot of new ideas, maybe? Or maybe you got a little bit of a headache from all that brain sucking that went on? I mean, really, a curse, a 300-year curse. And that's what you get. I mean, a fellow that turns into a monster with a very long tongue. If he had a little bit of horns, he would have reminded me of Krampus, you know, for around Yule time. And, well, anyway, We'll get back to that later on in the year. Right, Boris? Everybody knows about Krampus, and if you don't, I'm sure we'll tell you about him all over again and again and again. Anyway, so glad you can make it. So glad that you survived it. And I hope that you will return again, because we shall return. That's right, we shall return again for another episode of Monster Movie Night, right here on your same computer channel at whatever time that's in your zone. Anytime, every time, all the time. And also look out for our shows on Roku, Bizarre TV, Get Scared TV, Static Wasteland, plus YouTube. Not only that, but also stay tuned for our shows on The Vortex, as well as Eerie Late Night Horror Channel. We're everywhere, everywhere, everywhere. So beware, beware. We're coming for you, or you're coming for us. Either way, we'll be there. You'll be there, right, Boris? All right. So until next time, as always, keep screaming.